Welcome back to another very exciting tutorial here at the PhotoshopTrainingChannel.com. My name is Jesus Ramirez and you can find me on Twitter at JRFromPTC. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to create the long shadow effect. And I'll use an icon to show you the quick and easy techniques to do that. If you're not familiar with long shadows, you first have to understand flat design. And what flat design does is it removes any gradients, textures, and bevels and focuses on a minimalistic approach, and it uses only flat colors. It's really popular in websites and mobile applications. Long shadows started being used alongside with flat design and have also become really popular. A long shadow is simply a design element that gives the illusion that the object is casting a really long shadow. Long shadows are created using simple shapes and clean lines, just like flat design. It also uses a color palette that is bright and vibrant, and the color of the shadow is usually a shade darker than the hue of its background. However, sometimes you may see a long shadow with a soft edge or a gradient for a color. There are way too many long shadow styles that we can go over, but in this tutorial we're going to keep it simple. And before we get started, I do want to point out that if you're an Illustrator user, then you probably want to start there. To create a long shadow, you'll find that Illustrator can be a better tool, but this is the Photoshop training channel and you may not have access to Illustrator. So that's what this tutorial is about, to show you a couple of tricks that you can use to create that effect. Also in this tutorial, I'm going to show you how you can generate all the different image sizes of your icon for an iOS app or the different needs that you may have. This is going to be a template that takes advantage of smart objects. And even though we're using iOS as an example, you can adjust this template and make it work for an Android app or any other needs you may have. Obviously, there's a lot more that goes into designing icons, but this tutorial is meant to show you one of many techniques to create the long shadows and to show you how smart objects can benefit the workflow of graphic design. So we're going to get started with this file here, which is 1024 by 1024. The first thing I'm going to do is click on the custom shape tool to create my custom shape. The shape that I'm going to go for is this one here, which is a radioactive shape. If you don't see it, you can click on this icon, then click on all, press OK, and you should see all of the available shapes in Photoshop. So with the radioactive tool selected, I'm going to click and drag while holding shift on the keyboard to create the shape. Then I'm going to release the key. If I want to center this to the canvas, I can press Control A, Command A on the Mac to create a selection around the entire canvas. Click on the Move tool, and in the Options panel, you will see these icons here that will help you align the currently selected layer, in this case, the radioactive shape. I'm going to click on this icon here to align vertically, and this icon here to align horizontally. I'm going to then press Control D, Command D on the Mac to deselect. I'm going to go into the round rectangle tool, and I'm going to click in a corner, shift, and drag all the way to the corner. The properties panel opens up, and if you don't have that, you can go into Window, Properties to enable it, and you can click and drag on the corners here to increase or decrease the roundness of your icon. So for me, for now, I'm just going to leave it at about 133. And I'm going to click and drag that layer below the shape we created. And I'm going to select a blue color for this layer. Maybe this blue for the shape. I'm going to double click on the shape, choose white. And we have the first part of our icon. So this is a flat design. And now we want to create the long shadow effect that's really popular. So I'm going to Control, Command, click on the shape layer. And it's going to create a selection around that shape. I'm going to click above the rectangle, add a new layer, fill that with black. Black is our foreground color, so I'm going to hold Alt, Backspace, that's Option, Delete on the Mac. And I'm going to disable this layer just so you can see it. There it is. I have that layer selected. I'm just going to call this layer Shadow. Double click on it and just type in the word Shadow. And what I'm going to do now is click on the Move tool. And with the Move tool selected, I'm going to hold Alt, Control, Option, Command on the Mac, and then use the arrow keys on the keyboard, down and right, but you can do down and left if you want to. So down, right, down, right, down, right. And I'm just going to keep pressing those keys as fast as I can, just so you can see the extrusion that is coming out as I press those keys back and forth. And if you wanted to, you can add here, that could just be a little extrusion you're creating on the shape. And you can do this with text or any other layer. I'm just going to keep going, but you can stop if you want. And I'm going to go all the way to the edge so I can create the long shadow effect. And it may take you a while, and that's okay. Now, if you wanted to, when you get to this point, you can just create maybe selections. You know where the edge is. So you can just find the edges and just fill it in if you want to, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to just keep going a little bit faster until we get all the way to the edge. Okay, now that I got here, I really don't need to keep going because I can see that it's going to cover this part with black, so I'm just going to press Control D to deselect, Command D on the Mac, and then click on the polygonal marquee tool, make a selection out of that, and fill that with black, Alt Backspace, Option Delete on the Mac, Control D to deselect, Command D, and now we have the long shadow effect that we were going for. I can hold Alt, Option on the Mac in between the shadow and the icon layer to clip it. That way the round edge shows. Now I can do several things with this shadow layer. I can bring down the opacity just so it has a darker blue. And what you see here is actually the classic long shadow effect on an icon. There's more things you can do. There's different styles of long shadows. But keep in mind that you can do this with text. Like, gone ahead and created this earlier before we started the tutorial, and this is exactly what I just showed you just using text. One of the things you can do to the shadow is double click on it to bring up the layers style panel and bring the fill opacity all the way down to 0. That means that the only pixels that are going to be visible are the pixels that are created by applying a layer style, for example, a gradient overlay. I'm going to double click on the gradient editor, and I'm going to click on the top swatch here, which controls the opacity. I'm going to press 0 to make it invisible. Then I'm going to select a blue color here. Click anywhere on the gradient, it doesn't really matter where, and just select a darker blue, so maybe something like that. And I'm just going to remove this one, bring this one all the way to the right. Click anywhere on the gradient again, and that's just going to duplicate the last swatch that you had selected, which is that same blue that we used. I'm going to remove this white one, and I'm going to bring this all the way to the right. So now we only have blue at the bottom, but it looks like it's fading because we turned this into an invisible and actually went back to 60%. So let me move that back to 0. And now we have a long shadow effect with a gradient. I'm going to press OK. And you can also play around with the scale if you wanted to. And also maybe the angle. So maybe you want to do something like 45. But then that changes the darkness. So we can just click on reverse. And that's what you get. You can also click and drag and move that gradient around, or keep playing with the angle till you find something that works for you. I'm going to disable this layer for now. And another thing you can do with text is have each letter have its own shadow with the same gradient effect applied to it. And the result that you get is this right here. I created this beforehand, obviously, and it was the same effect, but I just selected one letter at a time, and then I created the shadow and applied that same gradient effect that I just showed you. If you add those two other letters, this is the effect that you get. And this is also another long shadow effect that is really popular these days. And in case you're wondering how you select one letter at a time, it's very simple. Just press Control, Command on the Mac, click on the text layer icon to load the selection. Then with the rectangular marquee tool selected, hold Alt, Option on the Mac. You see when I hold Alt, you get that minus on the marquee icon there. When you see that minus, click and drag to deselect that portion of the selection, and you're left with one letter. And then you just apply the long shadow effect as I showed you earlier, one letter at a time. I'm going to press Control D to deselect. Once you created your icon, you may be using this for something like an iPhone app perhaps, And one of the things that you can do is take advantage of smart objects to help you resize your icon for the various different sizes that Apple requires. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to add these layers into one group, and I'm just going to call this icon. Then I'm going to click on the render rectangle here, and I'm just going to bring the edge all the way to zero because I want a square. The iTunes Store does not allow you to have transparent pixels in the files that you submit. And if you have a rounded edge to your icons and they don't match the exact dimensions of the Apple roundness, then you're going to have a weird effect that you may not want. So it's better to submit a square icon and have Apple create the rounded corners for you. And I'm going to show you how you can create the different sizes just by using one smart object. I have this file here that you can download for free on my website, photoshoptrainingchannel.com. And it's actually very simple to use. You double click on this smart object titled Edit This Layer, and it's going to open up the smart object. I have a grid, I have a logo, and this is just a background that you can disable if you want. This is the placeholder logo. This is a grid that'll help you design an icon. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go back into the icon that we created. It's in a folder now. I'm going to click, drag, hold shift, and release the mouse button to place that right in the center. Now, remember that this no longer has a rounded rectangle, but the reason you're seeing it now is because this icon container here has a vector mask. If I hold shift and click on it, you'll see it disappear. I'm going to press Control S to save. Then I'm going to go back into the icon template and notice what happened. Just by using that one smart object, all the different icons change to the new design. And if I were to press Control Alt Shift S, Command Option Shift S on the Mac, you will come up for the save for the web window. You can choose PNG 24, click on save, and choose the folder where you want to save your files. Click save. And Photoshop is going to automatically take all those files out of here and put them into a folder. And I'm just going to use the save for the web window so I could show you what Photoshop did for us. It created all the icons that you will need. I'm going to press cancel, cancel. And again, this is available for download at my website if you want to use it. And the advantage is that the smart object allows you to make changes and automatically update all the icons that you'll need. Now, if you're wondering how I created this, I'm going to show you really quickly. I'm going to create a new window, and the document size really doesn't matter. All I'm going to do is I'm going to just quickly create an icon here. So the background, we'll make that this color blue. Then we'll add a custom shape. This clock here. And I'm going to click on this icon to create a new layer. I don't want to add to what we already have. I want the color to be white, and I'm going to move that into the box there. Press Control T, Command T on the Mac to transform. Hold Shift, Alt, Shift, Option, and scale it down a little bit. I'm going to do what I did earlier. I'm going to press Control or Command on the Mac, click on the icon, on the layer icon to load the selection, and use the range icons to center the clock icon onto the square. And I'm going to press Control D, Command D to deselect. I'm going to hold Shift on the top layer. While holding Shift, click on the bottom layer to select both of them. Then I'm going to right click on it and convert it to a smart object. Now that it's a smart object, I can hold Alt and drag it over to the right. And I'm going to hold Shift, Alt, and thus Option in the Mac and scale it down. Press Enter, hold Alt, Option, drag, hold Alt and Shift while dragging on the corner handle to make that smaller. So now we have three different sized icons, but in reality they're all the same one. If I click on the original one and I change the color to say pink, I can press OK, Control S to save, Command S on the Mac, and go back into the previous document, you'll see that they'll change. The reason is every time you duplicate a smart object, it's still tied to the original smart objects. If you make a change to any of them, it will affect all of them. If you want to create a smart object that is not affected by its parent, you right-click on it and click on New Smart Object via Copy. I'm going to drag this one down, and I'm going to make a change on this one, and this time we'll make it green. I'm going to save it, Control S, go back. You'll notice that there were all changed except for the last one that we created. So that's one way you can create a smart object without it being tied to the rest. And for the template file, after I created the icons, I had to set up the slices so it would be easy to save. So the way you create slices is you select the slice tool and you select the items, the assets that you want to save. For example, these. Then I can select the slice tool, double click on it, and give it a name. And whatever name I give it will be the file name once it's saved. If I click on Show Auto Slices, you'll see the other slices here. They're all numbered 1, 2, 3, 4. The ones that are highlighted in blue are the ones that were generated by the user, and the ones in gray were generated by Photoshop. The ones in gray you may or may not want to use depending on what you're doing. If you don't want to use them, if you double click on them, on Slice Type, select No Image, and press OK. All the items that are type of no image will not be saved when you do the save for the web window. Another way you can generate the assets is by using Generator, which is here under Generate Image Assets. I have a whole tutorial on that if you want to figure out how that works, but it's a way of saving files just by using layer names. Okay, and that's it for this tutorial. As always, I hope that you learned something new. If you have any questions, feel free to leave your message down below. And don't forget to subscribe to my newsletter, where I send you an email notification every time I put up a new tutorial and a tip of the day roundup every Monday morning. Also, don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel. Once again, thank you for watching, and I'll talk to you again soon.